This is the Choppin It Up show, brought to you by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. And now, here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Good evening, and I thank God for my unconquerable soul. Welcome to the Choppin' It Up show. I am your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you tonight. Today is September 9th, 2014, 6:30 on the West Coast and 9:30 on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live and or listening in podcast form, whether through iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, Facebook, Twitter, iTunes, YouTube, or any other social media device that you may have, or through our website. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. All right, we welcome September into the mix. And we want to say happy birthday to our blog, the number 4, themarchingpodcast.com. September 11th is the birthday for the blog, and that will be 3 years that our blog has been in existence. So we want to say happy birthday to the blog, happy birthday, and thank you to all those who checked out our blog, all those who follow the blog. Shout out to our editor, Colin Wilbon, up there in San Francisco. His birthday was actually yesterday. So, and my birthday is the 18th. My son's is the 23rd. So September is an outstanding month for all those people born. It was when everyone says that, you know, your folks got together at one of the Christmas or the Thanksgiving day parties. That's what they say. So we are the people who were born and conceived from great joy and a great time of year. That's what our claim to fame is. And, of course, a lot of us are Virgos, so they say that, you know, we are all good people with good hearts. So that makes sense. I understand. Yes, indeed. So happy birthday to all of those who have a birthday this month in September. It's the bomb, and we are the bomb, and so we will continue to carry that torch as so. Make sure you check out our blog, the number 4, themarchingpodcast.com, and check out our 2014-2015 90-degree show schedule. Check us out Sundays this season here at 8 o'clock Eastern for the 90-degree show. We are in week 3, and our featured matchup this week is the Southern Heritage Classic there in Memphis, Tennessee, Jackson State versus Tennessee State. This is a legendary event every year. And we'll touch base on Bethune-Cookman and the Carolina Kicker and Bama State, Tennessee State, some other things. Don't forget to vote on our website for week 2 of the winner of the Battle of the Bands. The matchup to vote on this week is Alabama State against Tennessee State. So go ahead and watch the tape and go to our website and vote for the band that you believe won the particular battle. So you make sure you do that, and as we get rolling along here tonight. So tonight, I want to go ahead and make sure that we get this moving along. But tonight is a very special guest, and that's a relative term because all of our people are special here. But it's my beloved cousin Jeff, Charles Beard Jr., I believe, named after the great Uncle Charles. Rue to your team out there. Love Uncle Charles, my father's brother. Uncle Charles is the baby of the family. RIP to, I believe, John Jeffrey was the last baby that was actually from my father's family. But he passed from, I think, complications at a young age. So Uncle Charles, the good old Uncle Charles, who I always thought was the funniest uncle, the comedian of the bunch, and really good to see him. I actually was in Jackson last year and saw Uncle Charles, and it was real cool not only to touch base with him as being one of the brethren, but also, you know, as a child, just hearing some of Uncle Charles's jokes, and now as an adult, being able to understand them. You know, Uncle Charles had a funny story about Aunt Pat. Shout out to your Aunt Pat. Much love for your Aunt Pat out there. I think he had a joke about his in-laws, and I think saying something about some Bermuda shorts and the air conditioner or something. He had air conditioning. He got the bill or something like that. I don't know. The point was, as a child, I didn't know what the hell was going on, but I just knew all the old people around me were really laughing really hard. And now, as an adult, Uncle Charles told me the story, and just thinking of a guy who lives out here in California and putting all of his hard-earned money into the power bill, I definitely could understand that and just laugh about it. So shout out to you, Uncle Charles. Shout out to you, Aunt Pat. Love you both very much. And so it was cool. So getting back as far as to Jeffrey's concern, I told you guys I'm my mother's only child, and both of my parents, proud HBCU grads, were not from my place of birth in St. Louis. You know, so I had two half-sisters. So when we would go out of town to visit my family in Jackson, it was fun because, you know, I could hang out with my family, people my age, my peers, and I wasn't accustomed to that at home. You know, I had a lot of people who weren't blood relatives to me, and some of the who've been guests on this show, like Chris Hartsfield, Jason Hartsfield, and, you know, my young cousin Vince up there. Shout out to you, Vince. Killer Bane up there in Madison, Wisconsin. But, you know, when I would go down to Mississippi, I was able to connect because it was blood, you know. And there was only four grandsons in the family. Now, later, shout out to your young Corey, was born. And then that made it five. But when I was, before Corey was born, and, you know, when I was younger, I would always go down to see my three male cousins. That's David, who you guys hear every night on the, he's like, he does the some of the voiceover stuff. He's our director of graphics and production, so to speak. I haven't come up with a full title. Jeff, who we're going to talk about tonight. And then Ryan, my other cousin Ryan, who you guys will probably hear from next year, we'll be chopping up with him. Another prior HBCU, great Jackson State, great graduate. But, you know, Jeff was special to me. Because he was the smart one of the bunch. He was always, like, you always knew he was going to be special and, you know, a productive citizen. You know, National Honor Society in high school, and really was responsible for, as someone that I could look up to. And really cool thing about Jeff was that he had a funny smile. He had this famous smile, and every time I would go to Jackson, I would try to smile like Jeff. And this went on for years. So, you know, I would go to Jackson and be hanging out with Jeff, try to smile, you know, walk around. And then at least for a week or two, you know, driving back to St. Louis and in St. Louis, I would be smiling like Jeff, you know, at school and everything. And, you know, I just want to be like Jeff in a lot of circumstances. You know, Jeff was special also because he played the trumpet. David played the trumpet too, so I always just felt like, you know, and then my dad, I was just like, okay, I know I'm going to play the trumpet. But also Marsh in the Sonic Boom of the South. Now, my other cousin, Candace, shout out to you, Candace, Jeff's older sister, she marched in the boom first. So she was Crab, I believe probably like Crab 89, he was 90 or something like that. And she was a Silver Streak. You know, she played flute. But since I was a guy and, you know, I played brass, when Jeff got in the band, it was like a whole nother world opened up to me. Really changed my life, to be honest. And we'll get into one of the stories that really that's really jumping out at me in the interview tonight. But Jeff has gone on to do great things and be one of the mature adults in our family. And I love him dearly and excited to talk with him and happy to play for everyone tonight. So you'll hear from my other cousin, Ryan, I'm sure, in the future. And that's Ryan, other cousin Ryan. And shout out to your Aunt Sarah. Aunt Sarah, her mother passed not too long ago, so you're in our prayers, Aunt Sarah. And shout out to Uncle Jiggs, the rawest uncle in the family. Uncle Jiggs, Floyd Jr., shout out to you. That's Ryan's father. And the guy who I'm, Ryan, that's Uncle Jiggs' voice. So you guys will hear from these guys. It's all, we're all intertwined together. You'll hear from Ryan in the future, but just love you very much, especially to David, Ryan, and Jeff. Just really made an impact on my life. And, you know, I didn't have, you know, those positive young males around me in St. Louis, but I'm glad I could able to, you know, we were able to roll down Highway 55 every Christmas or every Thanksgiving, you know, and I could see you guys. And it's good that we are keeping in touch with each other now. So this will, I'll get right into it. This will be a podcast, but we will accept your calls at 718-664-6025. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com. Tweet us at marchingpodcast. And follow our blog, blogs4.themarchingpodcast.com. If you are listening live and have a Blog Talk Radio account, you can join the chat room that I am opening up now. Was a little slow on doing that today, but that should be open here. Yes, it is open now. So if you have a Blog Talk Radio account, go ahead and log into our chat room, and you can leave your comments there. Last but not least, please check out the website, themartianpodcast.com. Let's take the time to hear from our sponsors. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liquid Effects Photography, Block Band Music, The Edge One Productions, Bandhead.org, and HBCUBands.com. Let's hear from them now.
This is Curtis from 80MinutesOfRegulation.com. From referees whistle to drum majors whistling back, your source for sports and marching and athletic music. You're listening to Choppin' It Up on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from pro base to band footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edge One Productions. Visit theedgeone.com and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Need to write music and drill? Get it on the field. Outfit your band. Keep your administrator happy and still have a life. Encountering drama in the process, ain't nobody got time for that. Let Block Band Music assist you with musical arrangements and drills to fit your band, and also the equipment, gear, and accessories to keep the visuals, music, and marching on point. Contact blockbandmusic@gmail.com and see how this worldwide minority-owned business can uplift your band.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is the social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
What up, bandheads? Are you looking for a talk show about HBCU marching bands? Well, look no further than the 90 Degree Show, brought to you by the Marching Podcast. Every Sunday during the football season at 8 p.m. Eastern, we recap the most intriguing battles of the weekend and give you, the listener, an opportunity to voice your opinion on the battle by calling into the show and talking with our panelists. Are you ready for the only interactive show in the world for HBCU marching bands? Then check us out Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. The 90 Degree Show, the interactive HBCU band podcast show.
Hello, This is Charles Cheese Waters, proud graduate of Rusk College in Holly Springs, Mississippi, and father of the owner of Block Band Music and Publishing. And you're listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we are back, and we are ready to chop it up with Cousin Jeff. Again, if you want to call in, you can do so on the number that you have there on your screen, 718-664-6025, at 664-6025. Make sure I enunciate my words correctly. We'll take those calls at the conclusion of the interview. So now, without further ado, Charles Jeffrey Beard.
You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and now with a wonderful and outstanding family guest here, we have the great Charles Jeffrey Beard, or Cousin Jeff, as I always knew him growing up. What's going on today, cuz?
Oh, we're having some good weather out here in Atlanta, Georgia. Glad to be on talking with you today.
I appreciate it, man. I was really excited to get you on. I've already chopped it up with our cousin David, and I know I'm going to be chopping it up with Ryan as well, but just excited to have you on. And then, of course, not only are we blood related, but also part of the same trumpet section, the great
trumpet section.
That's right. That's the greatest trumpet section in the world. So we'll get into that, but just I appreciate you having your time. I appreciate, you know, you being on the show today, cuz. So let's get right into it. Cuz, where are you from?
Oh, well, I'm from the great state of Mississippi. I mean, there is no other. But,
and,
yeah, I'm right there in Mississippi, Jackson, born. So, city, but a little bit of country still left in me.
Right. That's up. Now, your beloved parents, my Uncle Charles and my Aunt Pat, are they from... I know Uncle Charles is from Jackson. Now, where is Aunt Pat from?
She's actually from Monticello, Mississippi.
That's right. You know, and it's so funny, that brings it all back. I totally forgot that, but now I remember sometimes when we would come down there and I would be looking for you, and I'd be like, oh, where's Jeff? So I can hang out with Jeff. And they'd be like, oh, well, he's in Monticello this week. I'd be like, oh, you know. So now I remember now. That's right. You had to go see the other grandma and everything.
Right, and work the farm.
Yeah, man. That's right. So that's cool, cuz. Okay, so our folks are from that area. Our family is from that beloved area. Now, you growing up in Jackson, I know David talked about, you know, just, you know, being there at Jackson State, and you got Alcorn and all those show style band influences. What would you say was your first experience, you know, in the marching band, or, you know, seeing that show style type of marching?
Oh, man, boom of the South. Everyone wanted to play Get Ready. But it was really once I got into high school at Callaway High School there in Jackson, where a lot of the our influences came about. We're talking about generations of kids that were going from Callaway High School to Jackson State. You know, we would go to their high school day. You know, every point from sophomore year up to senior year, we would have an opportunity to go and sit in the band room and just kind of feel what it would be like if we could put those blue and white colors on and a big tiger on the back. So, we grew up around it, you know, going from shows to shows and game to game just to see the Sonic Boom of the South.
That's what's up, man. So, yeah, you definitely starting it early. That makes a difference. I mean, it's really similar to me. I wasn't around Jackson, but, you know, my dad did his best to make sure I saw the boom as much as possible, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so.
You're talking about you know, with our family, the actual name of the Sonic Boom of the South came from my dad when he was there during the period of 1968 to 71. So, you know, before that time, it was just the Jackson State Marching Band. But that's when we became the summa cum laude.
That's right.
Now,
my dad.
In, Yes, Jimmy James after that. Mm-hmm.
Jimmy James, that's right. He was the head of the music department when I was there, and he was also the voice for years when I was in high school, and then the years when I was there marching in the band, Jimmy James. And my dad, I know he always talks about they were called the best band in the land. I know that he always...
That's right.
He always talked about that. He always that's his favorite time, you know. He always loves to tell that story. So that's interesting. And shout out to Uncle Charles. Shout out to Uncle Charles
right.
out there.
He'd be glad to hear that.
Yeah, man. I'm sure he's probably listening. You know. So now we've got that great strong tradition there. You are at Callaway, and our cousin was at Callaway. David played trumpet. You followed in the tradition. What would you say made you play trumpet?
Oh, man, the first time I heard that sweet sound, I think it was Hot House Flowers, and, you know, I heard just the jazz sound, the trumpet that was coming from Wynton Marsalis. And I had an opportunity over at Jackson State to actually meet Wynton Marsalis. This is when our cousin David was at Callaway, and they were hosting something for anyone who would be interested later on in joining the band. And so here I am getting to meet Wynton Marsalis and over at Powell Junior High School and saying, man, if my cousin can do it, Wynton Marsalis can do it, so can I do it. And there we go. It started from there.
Yeah, man, that's really interesting you say that, because I met Wynton Marsalis myself in St. Louis. He came to – he played at the Powell Symphony Hall, but it was I don't think he played – I think he played with the orchestra one time, but he also played jazz with his jazz band, and I was able to actually go down there and meet him. And he let me play on his horn, but of course I was all nervous. I think I played a scale or something, but I mean, I was like, oh, snap. But they was back there playing pool, and so I was like, wow, this is crazy. And they was all cool, you know what I'm saying, you know?
Yeah, and that's when he showed us the wah-wah. I know you remember the wah-wah. You could put that attachment onto your trumpet, and oh, man, what kind of sound it would make.
Yeah. That's what's up, man, and it got to go about be saying too. You know, I play the trumpet because I saw you and David playing trumpet, and then of course my dad. But I was just like, everybody play trumpet. I just, you know, our other cousin Ryan, he played trombone, I believe.
Yeah, he messed up.
Yeah,
you know, that's all right. You can have one in the family.
Right. But that's what I was thinking. I was like, yeah, that's not. I was like, they ain't got the melody enough for me. You know what I mean? That's, you know, so that's how I, you know, watching you and seeing David, because, you know, I was a super shorty when David was in high school. So I saw more pictures of him, and I saw I was a little bit closer to seeing you play. But, yeah, just seeing that was one of the reasons why I started playing the trumpet. So that's cool, man. That's why I know I had to ask you that question.
Yeah.
That's what's up.
I'm proud of the generational tradition that we have there at Jackson State, especially with trumpet, because, you know, the trumpets carry that main line each time. So I can still remember us, you know, serenading the young ladies over at one of the oldest halls that we had over there at Jackson State right before we got to get ready to go to practice over in the air hall. So that we just have just a deep tradition, and you got to understand anybody that plays trumpet, my hats are off to them, because, you know, if nobody else is around, we can still make some sweet melodies. Isn't that right, brother?
Yeah.
We can still make sweet melodies.
Right. Correct. I mean, that is 100% correct. You know, that was one of the things that, you know, what definitely attracted me to the boom was that the funk. You know, it was important that they carried that line, you know, and it was part of the pyramid, you know, it was just part of just outstanding trumpet sessions there. And it was important, you know what I mean? I'm just thinking about all the little memories, and shout out to my crab class, Crab of 97. You know, we talked about this. I talked about my cousin. You know, and it's funny, too, and, you know, you remember your time going in as a crab and all that. You know, your name saved me. You know, my dad's name saved me. So shout out to Cousin Jeff and all the previous Funk members. You know, those names save folks. You know, when you can be like, oh, my cousin was Funk or my dad was Funk. You know what I mean? That helps. That goes a long way. You know what
hey,
I mean?
But, you know, we all had to brave our time as coming in as freshmen and trying to prove ourselves, right, to get that spot in the show.
Yeah, man.
I remember I had just come from basic training, you know, being in the military, and I'm coming in hard charger from infantry, and I wasn't taking anything from upperclassmen. But I had to get a spot because when I came in, they had already chosen everybody. So
oh, wow.
I didn't actually get to do the first round until Tennessee State. And from that point on, I was always on the field.
That's outstanding. That's outstanding. That's outstanding, cuz. So that actually kind of I kind of went into the Funk there, but of course we've landed out. You went to Jackson State. What would you say made you pick Jackson State?
Oh man, I have thought about different places. I had scholarship offers from everywhere, from Morehouse to Texas Southern to you name it, Stillman College even.
That's right, because you were National Honor Society student. That's correct, huh?
Right. So, you know, we all had that tradition of making sure that we did our books as well as extracurricular activities. But, I mean, we're talking about Jackson State. Jackson State was, you know, doing the Circle City Classics. They were up in Indianapolis. They were everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You would see them on TV, and I said, man, this is the perfect opportunity, besides the fact that my family said that you're not going anywhere else. But I digress. Right? This is it's a tradition, right?
Right, keep the tradition
going.
Yeah, man. And that's important to be said, just, you know, because now we have YouTube and we have Twitter, so, you know, I know, like, the little band heads and all that discussion now is so much, you know, internet, and someone has, like, a film of someone and they put it out there. So a lot more of the conversation is that. But back when you were in school and when I was junior high school, it was BET. You know, it was BET with the showcases. So they couldn't show everybody, so they would show the main – the big bands, the big hyper bands. So, like, and it would be like every Saturday doing it. It would be, you know, black college football, you know.
That's right.
It would be the game, but they also showed the halftime show. That was, and that's something that's definitely rolling into what I'm going to ask you later. But yeah, you would see Jackson State, definitely. And I mean, you would see Southern. I'm trying to think there was one other school that you would see all the time. I know they have Florida A&M on TV. But
yeah, I think they squeezed in folks like Johnson C. Smith and, you know, North Carolina A&T. We might see them or Grambling on there. But primarily, what? You had to have a summa cum laude band. That's who put the show together.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yep. Exactly right. That was the band that I saw. And, I mean, that just laid down so much tradition for years to come. You know, even still now, you know, Jackson State is one of the top programs and the top consistent programs. You know, Jackson State has been up there for a while now, and, you know, they haven't fallen off. So it's just outstanding, you know, because, you know, you were right there in Jackson. So for me, it was it was easier for me to go away from home because I definitely, you know, wanted to go away from home. My mother was like, oh, yeah, you know, it doesn't matter. You know, the question is where you're going to go to school. She's like, you going to school. She's like, where? My dad was more, I want you to go to Jackson State. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't too much. He wasn't hiding no punches about anything else, you know. He had an attitude about everything else other than Jackson State, you know.
And, that's funny how we grew up like that. And even before we had made decisions about our own educational destinies, our parents were already saying, well, my son or my daughter, you know, they're going to Jackson State. They're wearing the colors blue and white.
Right.
You know, they're singing Jackson Fair with me already. you know, they're not going to be one of the ones that's singing, I'm so glad I went to Jackson State, but did you graduate?
Right.
They weren't one of those. They were going to make sure we made it through the full program.
Mm-hmm. Right. And it was important, man, because, you know, I think all of us, because even still me, I wanted to do something else. I went to Johnson C. Smith first, you know, because, you know, I wanted to make my own mark somewhere. But it's hard once you get out there. And it's speaking just for me, but, you know, there are a lot of different bands now that are making their way. But back in the late 90s, having that true, you know, big black college BET experience, you were at Jackson State, you were at Southern, Florida A&M. Bethune-Cookman is big time now, but they weren't like that. They weren't all that back in the late 90s when I was there. They were good, but they're not too, like, nationally what they are now, you know.
No, I remember that 90 was an excellent year.
Mm-hmm.
For Jackson State. I mean, you had Dow Taylor there, you had Pops, you know, you had good writers. It was all kind of different music that was coming out during the time, and, you know, we got that initial invitation to you know, someone knew about Jackson State and get ready. So what perfect band to what? Go to Motown.
That's right.
Motown's anniversary, opportunity to see at that time Gladys Knight and Whoopi Goldberg and oh my goodness, I ran into Heavy D and the boys while I was out there. Smokey Robinson. Oh man, it was a good experience. It was a good experience.
So you
finished.
Yeah, you say. So you finished. Just for the listeners, you finished Callaway in what year?
I finished Callaway in 1990.
Okay, and then you were freshman in Jackson State's band in 1990.
That's correct.
Okay, and then that year, and that actually rolled right into my next question. I was going to say, because to me, you got two. You might got more, I'm sure. Everybody got more than two. Everybody got more than 10, I'm sure. But what would you say was that your most memorable experience in the Jackson State band?
Oh, man, there were so many. I mean, like I said, we had everything from Motown to, I think, the next year we got invited to go to the three-point shootout there in Charlotte, you know, the All-Star game. I mean, Jackson State was basically on a roll, and I was just a part of being a part of that whole thing, getting to be invited to Florida. I think probably one of the most memorable was a experience that we had. We got invited to a battle of the bands here in Atlanta. And we were battling with other bands. And I think during that time we were using a couple of funk melodies. And one of them was from Earth, Wind, and Fire, Back in Stride Again. And one of the other bands was playing Reasons. And we just kept going back and forth with different funk melodies. And the folks in Atlanta were just loving it. So I can't really point to just specifically one thing. You know, I do have one of those moments out there, like I'm sure others, where, you know, I was saying just one minute while we all do the bump and kicking that leg out of Joe Force on one of those segments with Jackson State. And I always take that as a good moment in time. But it prepared me for where I am here now. You know, we had rigid practices, just like if we were going through basic training.
Mm-hmm.
So when you talk about a Dow Taylor who wanted perfection, duplicity, you know, these, and it's funny, he would always come up with all these different types of words to say precision. but he got us ready. You think about where we all are today in going through the sonic boom of the South. You know, I look at things like LinkedIn and see some of my old colleagues who used to be in the band with us. A lot of them are directors and vice presidents and all kinds of things. They've gone on to create their own different types of companies, but that's based upon execution. And, you know, that's the only band that I know of in my personal experience that has done that for so many has been the Sonic Boom of the South.
That's outstanding, man. You know, it's funny you say that because I started thinking about all my friends doing the same thing. You know, I know some directors or, you know, some guys in the boardroom or just teachers, you know, just doing their thing now. And it's just really good to see, you know, and now, like, with Facebook, I see, like, these news feeds, you know, like, I'm sure you know Ollie Liddell, Dr. Liddell's son.
Oh, yeah.
He's in Memphis, I believe, and his band, his kids just won an award, and he had a picture on Facebook smiling, you know, a little Ollie smile, and in front of his kids. It's just like, wow, look at Ollie. I remember Ollie running around yelling at me in practice. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But it's a trip. It really is, just to see, you know, just to see that product. You know where we all are. But I have to tell you, man, that it involves you. My experience with you, and I think you led into it just previously. But you were featured there on BET. You were one of the faces of the BET halftime shows, and I think it was Homecoming against Texas Southern, I believe. I think that's what it was. And we watched it as a family every weekend. We would watch those black college football games every weekend, just like we watched the Cosby Show or whatnot. And they had you. They actually had Charles Jeffrey Beard in your face, because, you know, they would always show the full formations from back out, and then they would go on the field and show individual people, you know, and you would see someone's face, you know. But they actually showed you, just for a minute, let's all do the bump. That was from MC Hammer. I think that was it. What was that, Can't Touch This, or is one of them Hammer songs?
You know, Old Town 357 Days.
Yes, yes. So then y'all were in squads of four, and it's funny because we were always, we're Jackson State still squads of four, but, you know, at certain times on the dance routine when you did your four people or when people got together, a lot of times that was your squad. So I'm guessing that you and your squad went together and did the bump, and then you kind of ran back out and then, like, went off the line for two, back to the line for two, and then kickball chain, bow, 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 then back to attention. I still remember that, and I still remember how we were screaming. They were like, oh, my God, that's Jeff, and we were going crazy. So pretty much from there, I was going to a black college, and pretty much subconsciously, I was pretty much going to Jackson State, too. You know what I mean? It was imprinted in my brain pretty much from that point on. And it was just a good thing. It was just a memorable moment I'll just never forget, man. Other than, of course, the memorable moments, like our cousins know about Happy New Year and the pool table. You know, that's my memorable moment of Jeff, because I was so young with that. You know, I guess that was more for the older folks. You know what I'm saying?
yeah. We're not gonna bring that one up. Yeah, you don't want me to have a flashback.
Right.
I think about this whole experience, you know, as I had my time over there and my family started going to the games, you know, after I got married, and I could say, man, look at my boy over there leading him off. You know, I could watch you and go through the same thing that we did. And I remember your first year that you were marching with the band, and I had the chance to walk over, say hello to some folks, but to say, you know, that's another funk generation right there.
Yeah.
And get to shake your hand while you're in the old blue and white suits. Now, see, the folks now, you know, they got the new uniforms, you know. But you know how our uniforms used to be, you know, kind of pieced together with the torn out bottom. You know, you had to wear the biking shorts and so forth to kind of hide some things. But
right.
Man, we had some good times with those. Well, we had some good times.
Yeah, man. I remember those days. I remember that. And yeah, it was like I said, it saved me, man. He's like, oh, man, your cousin, he was in 90. Because, you know, just with everything, if you from a previous time, you know, you like, whoa. They like, oh, man, you get some respect. So, you know, I say my dad and then my cousins, whoa, like, oh, man, like, dude, oh, okay, dude is, you know, pretty straight. You know what I mean? And we would always see
like
them. Oh, go ahead.
It's like those old cats. You know, when it came to homecoming, and it's come around and say, "Man, y'all some Rudy Poots, man. I was here with Prop Davis." You know, it's like, okay, you were here with the big band sound. We're talking about the new generation now. We're talking about folks doing the show. You know,
right.
You know, we talk about dance band formation and doing those diamonds and so forth.
Yeah,
know?
Man.
Yeah.
So that's cool. So I know, you know, that all rolls out until, you know, graduation time. So what was your major there when you were at Jackson State?
Oh, man, you would bring that one up, man. I was pre-med and a brother that did not look like blood. Can you believe that? I was so bad over there that the dean told me, he said, "Man, you got to change your major. I think business would be better for you." So I finally ended up going over to the School of Business after probably my second semester at Jackson State. I was not going to be a doctor. I tried to go against the flow. But I ended up graduating, you know, to business administration with a degree in marketing and a minor in English. And, you know, it was the best thing for me to do because that helped kind of propel me to where we are today.
Well, that's cool. That's cool. So you were in business. What was your first couple aspirations, you say, as far as working? Where were you going to be in the business field once you hit the ground running?
Oh, man, it didn't matter. All I wanted to do was be a millionaire. I know that's what you know, I wanted to be just like Johnny Kemp. I just got paid
right.
And sell one record and don't sell anything else after that. I wanted to be one of those. No, but seriously, I wanted to open my own company. And, you know, I was pretty good in sales and was working during the same time while I was going to school. So, you know, business was in our blood. In fact, my father owned his own company while I was there at Jackson State. So, you know, anything in the business field was good for me. I mean, that's where we are today, and, you know, in banking. You know, I left telecom and went straight to banking. So,
well, that's outstanding. That's outstanding. So, so what is your official work title now? Because you also you have a great community service side, which is something we also like to focus here on the Marching Podcast Network. Where do you work now? And that's with banking. That's correct. You're in banking, correct?
Right. Okay. I'm in banking. I work for Suntrust Bank. I'm first vice president of consumer operations. So I'm really on the technology side, making different types of things from the online services to the core products and services that, you know, we provide to our clients, you know, like anything from insurance to personal savings to checking accounts, those types of things. So that's really what I do. I don't handle any money, but I'm on the tech side to make sure everyone else has an opportunity to sell. But then, of course, you know, we started off talking about, you know, the military. I'm also a United States Army Reserve chaplain, you know, 24 years of service now, and spent my time over in Iraq and here just trying to help out where I can. And with working as a chaplain there, I also, you know, volunteer as a hospice chaplain for those who are transitioning in life. So, you know, I have many different types of activities that I do, and because of that, I work as a hospice pastor, so... You know, you got my family life here with a little girl that's always active at 9 years old, and then I've got my business life, and then what I would consider my spiritual life too. And I just like to take care of people. As God has gifted us, we like to hand off that same idea of helping others.
That's wonderful. So I wanted to get it straight. So because it's kind of more from so when you're in the service, you get to work and be in the service. Like is it like part time service work? Because I've always assumed that like when you're in the service, it's like a full time job, like an 8 to 5 or something.
Well, you have that. You know, I did 3.5 years of active duty myself. You know, that could be a full time position. But then you have those of us who are called on by the government at certain times. But but also at the same time, you know, I have a full-time capacity to work down at Fort Stewart and some of the other posts, you know, once a month, or if I'm called on to do a special duty, like, you know, casualty assistance. And, you know, we never like those types of situations, but we get called on to help with angel flights. And that's when one of our service members is coming home and will be buried with special rights. So I could be called on at any time, but it's really just in a part-time capacity, like you stated.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, that's pretty cool. Yeah, I've always known you were in the service. Well, I've always known you to be a lot of things. I know you pledged a fraternity, and I know that you were in the service. And then, you know, when I heard you say Jeff is a chaplain, I was like, dang, say Jeff do a lot of stuff, man. And then I know you were overseas for a while. Now, also, that 1990, when, you know, we put that frame of reference back then, that's also to around the first Gulf War, correct, with Herbert Bush. And I remember being scared that you were over there like platoon. I thought you was over there like Forrest Whitaker. Like, I was like, oh my God, Mama Jeff over there throwing bombs at people. And she's like, I don't think so, so don't worry. So no. you were in that during that time, and you were over there in overseas. Could you talk about like your experience over there overseas? Like, were you scared at any time over there?
Well, I'm human. I'm just like anyone in that regard. So you're talking about someone who has going into a foreign environment, and, you know, it's new. But my situation, I probably would be closer to what was a Tom Hanks movie, you know, shrimp kebab, shrimp stew, and so forth. I had a couple of bubbles in my platoon, so it was a different type of experience then. But yeah, I started during the Gulf War, just like you stated. That, you know, that was Desert Storm. And that was our first session for being deployed. But, you know, that was Kuwait. Kuwait was different. Iraq was different. I've been to various countries, you know, Honduras and Panama and El Salvador and, you know, Qatar and all different types of places. But I'll say the scariest thing that, you know, I've ever experienced in my life was having, you know, mortar fire around us and, you know, still feeling that there was a sense of peace that was around me. And I know that was my relationship with God, but still feeling like, you know, something could happen and I'm away from my family. But, you know, I'm proud of where we are now, glad to be back home. But, you know, I still pray for those who are in harm's way over in Afghanistan and some of the other countries where our soldiers are. So, you know, hats off to what our soldiers are doing even today.
Yeah, man, because, you know, that's something that me, myself, I remember growing up. So, you know, I'm born 78, so really I kind of think like more, you know, grew up in the 80s per se. And a lot of that time was, you know, a lot of Vietnam War, historical landmarks, or like anniversaries and stuff like that. So I saw a lot of that stuff on TV. And, like, it was interesting to me, but then on a certain level it was, like, scary, too. Like, I was like, oh, well, this stuff is interesting to watch on TV, but I don't know if I could be the one out there running around doing it, you know. So just knowing that you were involved somewhat all the time, I was like, wow, that's something hardcore. Because, of course, David, Ryan, and myself never joined the service in any capacity, not that I know of. So that was just always something I said, Jeff, he harder than me, man, you know. So that's just something that's really cool. And then now to see, like you say, that helping people now in this capacity and what you're doing, it just all comes full circle. It's really cool.
Yeah.
It really is. But, yeah, to have the travel part is really outstanding too, cuz.
Yeah, I'll just say that I believe that God prepares each and every one of us for what we're going to do in life. And even though you all may not have taken those particular paths, I'll even say with our cousin Ryan, he's traveled, you know, to various countries himself and was able to find a good woman that is, you know, Portuguese in speaking. And that has helped to internationalize our family. So I think each one of us, you know, even you football player, you know, we've all been prepared for certain aspects in our life, and we've all got some good stories.
Yeah,
we've all got good stories.
Yeah, that's true. So we're getting somewhat towards the end of the interview, and I wanted, you know, if there's any information you out there, you know, where we can support you, we can do that. But I want to see if you have any advice. For any young person out there who's thinking about going to college and not really sure about their future. I know that, you know, I believe that you're a really good mentor and someone to follow, you know, someone who's going in a good direction. So, you know, people should, you know, take heed and, you know what you've done. Do you have any advice for those kids that are maybe looking to go to college or trying to decide what they're going to do? Or career-wise?
I tell you, the first thing is, go to Jackson State. You know, everybody's not going to go to Jackson State. Okay, that's fine. But wherever you end up, make sure that it's going to be a place that it's almost like you could call a second home. And that's what Jackson State was for us. It kept us comfortable. We have good, outstanding relationships. Since we've been there, people that we could depend upon to help us kind of network to find different jobs. I still network right now with Dr. Della Posey, who was my mentor at Jackson State when I was in the marketing department. It's those types of things that will help propel you forward. And the funny thing about that with Dr. Della Posey, she was my teacher for money and banking class. Can you believe that? And here I am in the banking environment.
Wow.
So you never know those types of relationships you need. Folks are going to talk to you and prepare you in ways that are going to challenge you in life. But you also want to enjoy your college experience, too. Now, you know, I know some people want to be a trendsetter, and, you know, I want to be the first brother or sister in this particular. Okay, you can do that. That's fine. But a lot of us want to be able to really enjoy that experience and build relationships. So go somewhere where you can be properly prepared to either, you know, run your own company or be prepared to be, you know, one of these executive officers that are starting new trends here all around the world. And Jackson State provides that in an international environment. So I would say just continue to go down that path.
That's outstanding, man. That's outstanding. And we really appreciate it, you know, your time and, you know, just me. And I said the same thing to David. You know, I didn't have an older brother or sister. And, you know, I didn't have any older brother. And that was important to me because, you know, when I would go down to Jackson, I would be always looking for you, Ryan, and David. You know, Corey, and I've said this before, Corey is another dude in our family too, but Corey's younger. So, like, when I was, you know, when Corey was born, Corey was little, so it's not like, you know, Corey had a car, or I'd be like, Corey, let's go hang out. Like, it would, you know, so it would always be you guys. And if you weren't in Monticello, or if you weren't working, or, you know, if Ryan was in town, or Davis went into town work, you know, I would always try to see what you guys were doing. And each one of you guys had something, I think, that I took and was a part of me myself. And, you know, you always were smart. I remember you had that National Honor Society sticker on, I think, your diploma. I think he's like, I want you to have this on your diploma, man. I was like, what is that? And you say, it's National Honor Society. And then when I figured out what it was, you know, I was like, hey, you know, I might have to pull on that one later. But at least I always knew that. I say, you know, if Jeff did it and he's in my family too, I know I could do it. I know I can graduate college. I know I could, you know, because I wasn't the same academically, but those times of despair, I could be like, well, I know Jeff did it, you know what I mean? Or, you know, I know our family, you know, got to this point of where they are through their education, so I know I could do it too. So I just really appreciate all of that.
Really saying. I know what you're really thinking on that. You know, if this country brother can do it, I can do it too. You know, he's a little bit slower than I am, you know. Down there, one of those pop drinkers.
So,
a sweet pea drinker. So if he can do it, I can get through here.
You know, it's funny. It's funny you say that too, Jeff, because I know my mother, she would all, for some, there was something, she just never figured it out to her, but I just never could dress appropriately to my mother. And now I'm teaching class, I try to make sure that I dress up so I command a certain amount of respect. But you always dress nice to go to school. I'll never forget that. I was like, damn, Jeff wore that to school, you know. And for me, that always tripped me out. But my mother, oh, man, my mother, that would just break her heart. And my grandmother, too. My mother's mother, she'd be like, Joseph looks a sight sometimes. Why does he dress like that? You know, and I don't know why. I just would feel comfortable in just bummy clothes. But I knew that it was in my family. Even my dad dresses nice. I don't ever think I ever saw my father in a pair of jeans, I don't think. But it was always in the family line. I knew Jeff. I said, "Well, I know they be dressing." You know what I'm saying? So that was just something else
he
I tried.
Me, man. Believe me, Dr. Beard inspired me with that BMW. When y'all came down, as soon as I could get a BMW, brother, I got a BMW.
Right.
5 Series.
Yeah, man. So I knew it was always in the family. But I appreciate everything you do, Jeff, and really glad I was able to catch up with you because, you know, I'm doing the podcast now. It's been a good opportunity for me to touch base with people. So I'm glad that I got to you. And, you know, we both know who each other is and we'll be able to plan about seeing each other in the future and everything. So I love you, cuz, and I really appreciate
love
your
you
time
too,
today.
I appreciate you, too. And, hey, we look forward to getting out there to get to Disney. So let's look to put that thing together. And thanks for allowing me to be on the podcast with you.
Definitely. And I'll let you know when I play it. But, yeah, it'll be all over, you know, Facebook and Twitter, you know, like I do all the other ones. And I'll be putting it on the, of course, the Sonic Boom alumni. I am now financially part of the organization. I sent my $35 in there to Renee. Shout out to you, Renee Baker. Appreciate you know, appreciate the shout out. But, yes, I am now officially, I feel entitled now. So we will definitely let the organization know about this its interview so, you know, they'll be able to hear it.
All right. Well, you enjoy the rest of the weekend, and we'll be talking with you, sir.
All right, cuz. I appreciate your time, cuz.
Thanks, man. All right. God bless.
All right. We're back live, and it was really great catching up with Cousin Jeff. I had forgot, and it's, you know, every interview I forget something about everything, and then, you know, I edit and I play it later, but it's always good to catch back up with those people. Just always good to catch up with family members like Jeff. Again, if you are interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Martian Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out information through social media. And, you know, please go ahead and contact us so we can help build your business, and we'll be honored to do so. Again, we are, you know, looking for any businesses, but definitely businesses we believe in will always help stir and turn the network. Again, you're welcome to call in during the last commercial break before we sign off at 718-664-6025. Again, thanks again to all listening, and we'll hear from our sponsors one last time before we sign off for the night.
Hello, this is Dr. David A. Paget, Director of the Geographic Information Sciences Lab at Tennessee State University, and you're chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, you're about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity. Come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquidfx.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from probates to dance footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edgemont Productions. Visit theedgemont.com and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Fan Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
What up, Bandheads? Are you looking for a talk show about HBCU marching bands? Well, look no further than the 90 Degree Show, brought to you by the Marching Podcast. Every Sunday during the football season at 8 p.m. Eastern, we recap the most intriguing battles of the weekend and give you, the listener, an opportunity to voice your opinion on the battle by calling into the show and talking with our panelists. Are you ready for the only interactive show in the world for HBCU marching bands? Then check us out Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marching podcast. The 90 Degree Show, the interactive HBCU band podcast show.
This is Janice Craig Hartsfield, proud Spelman College alumni, class of 1964, and you're listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we are back live, and we appreciate that. Looks like I've flipped up with their Aunt Janice there. We listened, we chopping it up, of course, but it looks like I flipped out the audio tips there. But it's all good. Thanks a lot for all the listening. I don't see anyone in the call room tonight, and I apologize for taking this back 30 minutes because my son is in a swim class. So I'm all excited, but the swim class doesn't get out till 5:50, and my son in locker rooms, it's not a pretty sight, let me tell you. But thanks again for all those who were able to listen despite the time change. And of course, you can always listen to this episode, as with any episode here on the Marching Podcast Network, by using the same link that you are listening on right now. Listen to us at themarchingpodcast.com. Follow us on Twitter. Email us. Holler at us in any type of capacity. Like us on Facebook. Follow the blog, Happy Anniversary Blog. Happy anniversary to myself and happy anniversary to my son. Thank you very much. The numbers have been increasing a lot recently. And just like my cousin was saying, man, if you hold on long enough, you know, this will catch some fire. But I believe in what we're doing, and I believe that we are changing the world. And again, this just is not me. I am just highlighting all of my friends and all of my peers who did much better in music than I did, let me tell you. But just doing a lot of things in all aspects of life. Shout out to the fifth quarter and all the people hating on the fifth quarter. Every time I hear some hate type of stuff, I see like later in another conversation that we agree. So we all connection. We all the same people. in and out, no matter what's going on. So I even thank you to the haters out there. And I really appreciate everybody. I think everything is growing, and I believe in this. You believe in this. So I'll go ahead and let it out, play out. But again, thanks to you for listening. And remember, the advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. And the lessons and the lectures you may give may be very fine and true, but I'd rather get my lessons by observing what you do. See you next time.